Hello, this is Jack Jackson. In this video, we're going to be introducing the idea of descriptive statistics. We've done a couple of videos before this, introducing some basic terminology and give us an overview. Now we're going to dive into the first big unit of descriptive statistics. So recall that descriptive statistics is used to make sense of data, allowing us to effectively find and communicate important information from the data set in order to reach conclusions and make good decisions. That's what descriptive statistics is. It organizes and makes sense of data, uses numerical and graphical methods, identifies patterns in data, isolates and summarizes key information, simplifies the information focusing on the items of interest, and eliminates undesired information to avoid information overload. So basically, what we've got is we've got all this information. We may collect it. It's unorganized. It has lots of different things. We may want to eliminate some of it and focus on one particular thing at a time, which sort of gets rid of that information overload. And then we organize it somehow or another. There are ways to do this in terms of graphs and charts and tables. And there are numerical ways of describing certain basic characteristics of that data. All this is what we mean by descriptive statistics. So descriptive statistics is definitely the easiest part of this course, the part we're starting with. But it does provide a foundation for everything that we're going forward. And you can do a lot of things with descriptive statistics. Now, often we're going to be looking at charts and graphs, particularly, you know, some graphical or visual ways of representing information. And when you do this, there's several things that should always be there. And I've definitely seen examples which violate this in print even. So be careful that you're sure to use these things. The first thing is it needs a clear descriptive title. So there needs to be a title with that chart or graph. And there's, of course, different formats for that for different types of publications. But it should always be there saying what the basic graph or chart is about. Then we should also label charts headings and axes. So when you have axes, oftentimes there'll be a horizontal and vertical axis each. You need to explain what those are. And they need to have a consistent numerical scale and units on there. So your scale can't go 1, 2, 7, 15. If it goes 1, 2, then it needs to be 3, 4, 5. It needs to be evenly spaced out. So it needs to be consistent. It needs to have units with that. Well, it's 1, 2, or 3, what? You know, maybe it's hours. Maybe it's feet. Maybe it's whatever. So whatever it is, you need to be sure you include that scale and the units with it. Another thing that's often left out is you need to cite the source of your information. Where did this come from? Particularly if this graph is pulled out of context, from somewhere else, you need to cite where that information came from. A chart or graph should be used to clarify and not distort the data. So there are many ways that you can look at a chart or a graph, and it distorts the data. It does not accurately represent what's actually there. It must be accurately representing and not distorting what's actually there. And I'll look at some specific comments on that a little and as we go along here. But it should also be easily read. So when you do a graphical representation, you should actually be able to at least pretty well read off the numerical data from the graph. So it needs to be precise. And the chart or graph should emphasize the characteristics of interest. It should get your point across, in other words. So speaking of characteristics of interest, what kinds of things are we interested in measuring in descriptive statistics? So I'm going to let you think about this question and maybe come back in a few minutes after you've kind of identified some things. So when we are analyzing and representing data, what are some general characteristics of the data we might be interested in measuring? Think about that and see if you can come up with some ideas on your own. Press pause now. Well, hopefully you maybe come up with some of these ideas here on the next slide. These are the things that we're typically interested in measuring for a data set. Sometimes we're interested in all these, sometimes only some of them, but these are the most commonly measured things. The first one is just size. How big is the sample, or how big is this population, or how big are the parts of the sample, the different subparts? So measures of size are extremely useful and important. Next, we have a thing that we call measures of relative standing. Relative standing basically measures the question, how does a value compare to the rest of the values? So measures relative standing would be things like, what is the lowest value? What is the highest value? Those are called the minimum and the maximum. Or what's the value in the middle so that half the value is below it, half the value is above it? That would be a measure of relative standing, or a measure where 80% is below it. Those would be measures of relative standing. Measures of central tendency are probably the most, or one of the most important things that we want to know about a data set. And what is its center, middle, average, or typical value? And those words, center, middle, average, typical, are somewhat vague, but we have specific ways of measuring the center. We have what we call the mean, the median, the mode, or the three most common ways of measuring central tendency. And we have a couple others that we'll study as well. Variability is another thing that we're interested in. How spread out is the data? Or the opposite of variability is consistency. Is it very consistently, tightly packed in around some particular values? Or is it really spread out? Okay. Another thing we're interested in doing is identifying if we have what we call outliers. So in other words, are there any unusually large or unusually small data values that are very atypical of what's going on? So one particular number that's just way higher than everything else. Now, sometimes you can have an outlier because you measured something incorrectly. So there could be a data collection thing, so it's actually an incorrect data value. And then sometimes it's a correct data value, but there's just something unusual about that particular one, and that should be investigated and explained if we can. Another thing that we're interested in is shape. If we were to sort of spread the data out and look at it, is the data spread out evenly, or is it mounted up in the middle or to one side or the other? Is it symmetric? Okay, these are interesting things that we're interested in. That's called shape. And of course, we're really interested oftentimes in comparing two data sets and see how they compare to each other, or comparing one data set as it changes over time. If we collect similar data at different times, do we get significantly different results? So basically, that's going to be our organization for our first unit here on descriptive statistics. If you think back to what we've done in the videos so far in the notes, we introduced basically probability and statistics in general. Try to answer the question, what is probability? What is statistics? Just the basic definitions of that and the branches of it. And then we talked about descriptive statistics, introducing that in this video. And now in the next videos, in the next sections, we're going to be talking about measures of size, measures of relative standing, measures of central tendency, measure of variability, outliers, descriptions of shape, changes over time, and then we're going to come back at some point and then talk about working in some technology with this. Actually, we may end up moving that up a little bit earlier, but we're going to talk about using technology with this. So these are basically the organization of what's coming left in this sections within this unit on descriptive statistics, and each one of these will likely have more than one video within it.